the enlightened gathering, by suing whom we can feel that Swamiji may be feeling happy in his divine abode, that there are so many energetic and learned people to carry forward his message. Namaskar to all of you. I deem it as my privilege to have been invited to this distinguished gathering in this glorious institution. As all of you are aware, for the past 1 year, the 150th birth celebrations are going on all over the country, and I had the fortune of associating myself with some of them. But of all of them, I treat this as a rare honor. The reason is that this is the source of inspiration forever to carry on the message of the great sons of Mother India, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsaji and Swami Vivekananda. Any attempt by me to impress upon you about Swami Vivekananda will be a misadventure, because it is something like taking a glass of water out of a tank while being in the tank itself and seeing that I have taken one glass of water. You are within the Ramakrishna Math, and any attempt by anyone to say that he knows something better about Swami Vivekananda will be a misadventure. All the same, if we can treat the continued subjugation of India, continued invasion or foreign rule of India, as a curse, as a dark phase, and as a an unfortunate development for this great country, we can easily say that was neutralized by the shining sun like Sri Swami Vivekananda, shaped by Swami Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. If you just peep into the history of the recent past, the country was, first of all, the country reached its height in all forms, not only spiritual side, but achievement on every aspect. Name any subject of study, even of modern study, that we have climbed the highest levels. Take chemistry, medicine, alchemy, physics, radiography, everything, you will find it. I'll give you only one example, or two, three, just so that being the students, you would know, all of you may be already aware of it, but to recollect your memory. In medicine, even today, modern medicine also, the textbook all over the world in anatomy is Gray's anatomy written by Gray. That is the textbook throughout the world. In that, you will find a chapter in this plastic surgery. The first word written there is, first sentence is, the first plastic surgery was conducted by Sushruta. Albert Einstein, one of the acclaimed scientists of the world, observed that but for India's inventions in mathematics, whether it is concept of zero or others, it would not have been possible for the modern scientist to achieve anything. Quadratic equation, which many people attribute to Sir Isaac Newton, was invented in India, and it was taken from some Kerala tradesman to that place. You can go on multiplying the instances. And if you look into the Vedic, they are all in, whether it is Vedic mathematics or anything, even present scientists would be astonished. I'll give one instance written by Paul Brunton. Paul Brunton came to India about 100 years ago to understand the secret spiritual developments in India. Then in Calcutta, he went to a professor's house. Then they were discussing about this thing, and he said that professor is said to have told him that in India, science and spirituality grow simultaneously and one does not claim superiority over the other. Then he gave an example. One nursing, his name was Nursing Sadhu. His name was like Nursing Sadhu. He is an ascetic. He doesn't exhibit anything. But somebody challenged him that science is great and all that. Then here the Presidency College in Calcutta is one of the oldest institutions, very famous one. That was at, this incident took place at a time when Sir C.V. Raman, a Nobel laureate, was there. Then, during the course of discussion, it was said that this man is capable of swallowing everything, including potassium cyanide, but he will be intact. Then the scientists were not, because any scientist will naturally challenge it. Then he was invited to Presidency College in open ground. Renowned scientists, including Jagdish Chandra Bose, attended. Everybody was there. This sadhu was given diluted acid, sulfuric acid and nitric acid. 200 ml, he simply drank it and just leave it at that. Then they tried with concentrated acid. He too took it first in hand, thereafter he drank it. Nothing happened. Then potassium cyanide, by taking his signature, every precaution was taken, potassium cyanide was administered to him. He took that and he was perfect. Then all glass was made into powder pieces, he was asked to eat it, he did it, he was intact. Ultimately, a great person like Jagdish Chandra Bose had to confess that we have our own limitations, science cannot answer anything, everything. That is the thing. I'm only trying to impress upon you the heights to which our people have taken. Yes, science and other things are perfect in their own way, but there is much more than what we understand, and it is, we cannot understand that ultimate. Just now we have seen our beloved students singing that Purnamadam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. That is the ultimate definition of the constant. In every mathematics study, we will come across constant. You can't define what it is. Purnamadam is, that is full, that is complete and absolute. Purnamidam, this is complete. And Purnat Purnamudachyate, if you take something from the full remains. And if you add something full, it remains as such. So that is the understanding, real understanding of the nature. On the other side, on spiritual side, on the spiritual aspect, we have reached the highest levels. And what did we say? Normally we come across situations where a great personality gets enlightened. He comes into contact with the divine God and he propagates his own thing. He stipulates a set of norms and say that do this and don't do that. And a sect gets prepared. But what is our approach? Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha. We don't discriminate anybody. We want everybody to be happy. That is our motto. So Swami Vivekananda deeply pondered over as to what has gone wrong with the country, which is such a great achievement of both spiritual and on non-spiritual side. We have reached such heights, then why is it people, we are being ruled by some other persons who are just nothing before us in terms of our learning? He understood the gist of everything, and ultimately he wanted to awaken the people, and he rested his hopes in the youth. Because youth alone can have a determination, because a grown-up people may have their own avocations, their own limitations. But he pinned hope upon the youth and prepared them for the resurrection of the great India. But it was a very great and stupendous task. He had to undergo several ordeals, several obstruction, he has to come across several hurdles and obstructions for that. And ultimately, he's almost an experiment like thing was in the Chicago. Now those two words, brothers and sisters, because it will be, if I elaborate on that, it will be a rhetoric, all of you are aware of that. Just the whole audience in a foreign country, when a person whom they have seen with utmost contempt, because he was given 2 minutes, and for them, nothing, this India and Hinduism was nothing, and there was they were not even aware of that such a thing exists in the world. But when this man, such a person, has simply said brothers and sisters, they were so exclaimed that a person is addressing us like that. So he did not stop at that. If he has sowed the, if you are seeing something in United States or other places where they have got utmost respect for our works and culture, it is on account of the seeds sown by Swami Vivekananda. We find that the yoga centers, even in Harvard University, a special seat is created to study this Karma Siddhanta. What they have seen is that two persons with same ability, with same qualifications, with same capital, if they start industry, the results are not equal. Why? Then ultimately they have to come back upon our Karma Siddhanta, and they are studying it. That is how Swamiji has just given a sample of the greatness of India to those places, and nobody has any qualms about it. Here I would like to just the place given to women in Indian culture. This is not an exaggeration, and you take anything, you take the field of learning, we know it after Goddess Saraswati. Valor and the courage, Goddess Durga. Then prosperity, Goddess Lakshmi. And everywhere. And it is not as if some person who is not well aware of it has done it with full accomplishment. However great a person may be, he is just humble before his mother and his motherland. So that is the greatness of our culture. Recently, one instance has taken place as to how the rest of the world will feel the distinction. One person, fairly educated, went for employment to some Scandinavian country, Norway or Denmark. There he did not get accommodation, he arrived at that time. He found one old woman making an effort to get a taxi, but on account of her age, she was unable to get it immediately. This man just went to her help and got a taxi, arranged it for her. Then that old woman was a bit astonished. Who are you? Why did you think of helping me? Then he said, madam, you are like my mother, if not my grandmother. There is nothing serious about it. Then where are you? He said, I am as of now without any shelter. I am looking at. Then that old woman, she said, I am alone. You appear to be somewhat interesting. All right, since you don't have shelter, you accompany me to my flat. They went there. And soon after he landed there, he took her luggage, went there and helped her to settle the things, and as we do in our houses. This woman was getting curious, why this man is doing all this? One day, 2 days spent like that, he was fetching her food, clothes, everything. Then coolly, she asked, why is it you are doing? Madam, this is the thing which we do to our mothers and old women everywhere in our country. She did not believe. That man was from West Godavari, some place. She, out of curiosity, she was telling, it is not as if I am without any children. I have got sons, I have daughters, my grandchildren are there. No, except on the Thanksgiving day, we do not even meet. What is all this? Then she came all the way to Vizag. From Vizag, they have to come to this country. When this man was landed there, there was a lot of gathering, their relations, the particular woman, folk, children. She thought that this man has arranged it, knowing that she is going to come and all that. Without disbelieving this man in his house, because she found so many women, this three generations of people in one house, not so rich and all that. She coolly went outside and went on looking at the family, whether it is a hut or a tiled house or something. Everywhere, one older, middle-aged parents, their children, their grandchildren. Ultimately, she said, if there is any heaven on the earth, it is India. And so all that fame, whatever it is, we get because of our respect for women. And it is, if families are like that, it is only on account of the love and affection which the woman folk inculcate in the children right from the childhood. If Shivaji has grown up like that, a great hero who has liberated Maharashtra and created such a big empire, it was only on account of the training given to him by Jijiabai. Now, sometimes people try to claim some superiority over women folk. That we come across. This, I'll not take much of your time, but one interesting story is about how even at a later stage, women folk can afford to teach the values to women. Pandarnath at Pandarpur is a deity worshipped by many, and one of the greatest devotee of Pandarnath was Namdev. It is said, just as our Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was in talking terms with Ma Kali, he was in talking terms with Pandarnath. Then, almost in a conversation-like thing, Namdev asked, Swami, when is the liberation for me? When I get liberated? How long shall I wait? Then Pandarnath replied, your revelation is not yet ripe. You have to learn something more. You feel that you have learned everything, but you have something more to learn. Then where should I learn? Where? Just you observe old couple, wife and husband, come to my temple every day. One day you come, accompany them wherever they go. Then you tell me later on. That aged couple, they are the residents of that village. Their duty is, they go to the forest, collect the fallen out wood sufficient to fetch them the price for their food. They sell that bundle of wood and sell it, eat the food, just go on chanting Pandarnath, and in the evening go to the temple. That is their daily routine, no other thing. Then Namdev was accompanying from a bit distance. Those couple were going. Then, as though to test the temptation of those people, there was a old bag full of golden coins. The bag tore away, some coins came out, some were inside. Fairly quite a considerable quantity of gold. The old man was going a bit ahead. His wife was following him. He thought, this gold is a very dangerous source. I will become greedy if I take it. So he passed away. He did not take it, because if he was to acquire wealth, he would have done something more. But he was totally devotional. He went ahead, but thought that, yes, being man, I have overcome temptation. But my wife is a woman. She will be very fond of gold. Lest she becomes greedy by seeing it, what he did was, he came a bit behind and covered that gold with some clay, that dust. Then she proceeded, both of them proceeded. Then at a point she asks, you bent there, what did you do? He said, I have covered gold so that you will not get tempted. She says, you have covered one farm of clay with another farm, and you feel you are a great champion. So see the accomplishment of those persons. So her level of the level of accomplishment of that woman, at least this man distinguished between gold and clay, but she did not distinguish. She, for her, the gold and clay were both equal. It is because we get gold only from earth. So both of the equal, what is the great sacrifice you have made? So that is, when Namdev sees that, oh, this is the ultimate achievement, where you will treat everything equal and you will not get tempted. So he got that lesson from that old woman. Ultimately, he gets the emancipation. We can repeat so many things, but the society around us is not that ideal as it used to be. Particularly for youth, there are many temptations. For no fault of them, they are forced to see them. Whether you see a channel or anything. Recently, I had occasion to participate in a school days function. One of the guests invited there was the producer of a Telugu serial which runs about 500 episodes. I don't know what its name is. But that man said, for my livelihood I have produced that serial, but please don't look into it. And see, the recently we have seen our shop corner, the street corners are with KFC, McDonald's and all that. These pizzas, KFC pizzas and burgers. So naturally everybody tempted. Well and good. But what did the McDonald's and the KFC, they have issued a directive to their employees. What did the employees, they give a code of conduct for their employees. The code of conduct says, don't eat those things. They will add to your weight, you will become obese, you will become prone to the diabetes and all that. For their employees, they give the directive and advice. And for us, they supply it to them at doorsteps. What all you need is some phone call, they will put you at doorstep. So that is how, unless we are a bit careful about these developments, subconsciously, not that nobody will make an effort to get spoil himself. Subconsciously, we become the slaves to certain things, and these things, they will slowly change our pattern. Friends, the time has come for us to reinvent our values. Sometimes people may say, if you speak about values, you are a retrograde, you are not a forward thinking, you are not a progressive thinking. All right, long live progressive thinking, but as long as we cherish our values, our culture will be safe and we will be safe. Otherwise, we are unable to distinguish what is development and what is destruction. Take for instance, we call it, sitting in Hyderabad, we treat ourselves as very advanced, cultured people. And those in the villages are rustics. I will take the example of women folk itself. If in the village a woman walks with full of ornaments, first people will get exclaimed. Suste Mahalakshmi lagundi, she is looking like Mahalakshmi. He will not envy as to where from you got the gold or ornaments. Second thing is, they will just respect and nobody will think of having that. Now, in city, we have reached a stage where, in big colonies also, if a woman wants to go for walking or to shop, she has to remove Mangala Sutra. Where is the culture? This is and I am told in United States, in many cities, if you don't put money in your pocket, somebody, if he comes across, if you don't have money, he will kill you because his effort is going waste. Therefore, they advise you to keep at least $5 in your pocket so that if the moment the gentleman comes with pistol, you put that $5 in his, he will go away. If you don't give it, he will shoot at you. See the type of cultures. Therefore, let us not be hypocritic about something and call it as a culture. Swamiji has always been keen to reinvent our cultures, cultural values. Even great people, even learned people like this Nani Palkiwala, he wrote a book on that spiritual heritage of India. This heritage, and this Mark Twain, he said, India is the cradle of the civilizations in India, of the world. It is the cradle. And if the cradle is damaged, it is not to the owner of the damage, it is the stake of the children. The prospective children will be deprived of that. There are many who have just exclaimed at the cultural heritage and cultural values of our India. And Swamiji has brought name and fame to us. What all we have to do is to carry it further. Many a time, we find some lame excuses. Suppose our Vande Mataram is there. We chant only first two stanzas. In the other stanzas, there is our tribute, our respect for God Saraswati, Goddess Durga, Tvam Durga, Tvam, ani atla. There is, we pay our respects to that. That part of it was removed by saying that people from other religion are objecting to it. That is a lame excuse. Our people never objected. I will give an example. Last night also Swamiji knows I gave an example. Indonesia is a country with 90% of Muslim population. Then normally one expects them to not have, they don't expect them to have so much of regard for our deities or goddesses and all that. They have presented Indonesia as a country, not even some agency or organization from that place. Indonesia as a country presented the statue of Goddess Saraswati with 18 feet tall Saraswati statue was presented to United States, and that is installed right opposite to the White House. That is the respect they are showing. So where is this disrespect and all that? And one more example. Vivekananda Kendra people, they always, every year they conduct some tests. 2-3 months before this Swamiji's birthday, they distribute information booklets which contains information about Swamiji, and they conduct a test. When they invited me, I also asked them to do the same thing in our village in a government school. There it was done, and the first prize was secured, was obtained by a Muslim girl. That is the culture of India. Only to express, what happens, suppose the human tendency, if I don't like something, what I will say is, so and so does not like it, therefore don't get it. Actual disliking is on my part. And if I am inclined to eat something, you know, so and so person, the boys want it, therefore get it. Boy never asked it. This man wants it, therefore in the name of boy, he gets it. These hypocrisies must stop, and whatever is good in the society, there is good in every walk of life, in every religion, whatever is good for us, let us adopt it, practice it, inculcate it. And if it is bad, one should not hesitate to call it as bad. Now, the path for righteous conduct is not that easy. Sometimes arrogance overtakes us, sometimes hesitation comes. Take for instance, Swamiji, in the Chicago, he got the fame all over the world. Paper after paper acclaimed his achievements. And almost he was a conqueror in the entire parliament of religion. Then after he came to India, any person, suppose one of us, at least let us go to some conference held outside. There you are declared first. With what feeling you will come here? everybody should go and come and respect you. You will arrange. If somebody does not arrange, you yourself will arrange for it. And if you have gone on a pant and shirt, you will come back with a trouser and tie and coat. Our whole of it will change. But what about Swamiji? The moment he landed there, he just took the sand in the bank of Kanyakumari, just poured him as though it is a some mad people do it like that. He was so exclaimed that, "My country is so great, my country is so great, I have virtually redeemed my debt to the country," like that. So he felt, he became far humble. And even when the Raja of Ramanathapuram, he wanted to do so many honors, just to touch feet and all those things. He stopped all those things, but still that Raja insisted that in a chariot Swamiji was made to sit, and Raja, that king of that Ramanathapuram, has pulled the rope. These temptations, unless we overcome, they will come as a hurdle for us. Truthfulness and simplicity. Simplicity has got its own virtues. It will fetch us so many things. First, it will cut our unnecessary expenditure, then make us humble. Let us recognize that there are many people who are greater than us in every field. But at the same time, we are not something trash. There was a beautiful quotation in our region engineering college. I always liked it. In auditorium, in those days, pot crash was the champion of badminton. But the saying is, you may not be pot crash, but you are not a trash. One need not be the highest, but at the same time, you are not the lowest. You are you, whatever you are, that's all. But if you recognize your inner strength, that is what Swamiji always exhorted us. If you recognize your inner strength, there is nothing which you can't do. All you need is that, yes, you are a great source of power by yourself. What all you need is firm determination in two things. Determination in choosing your goal and determination in pursuing it. Mere choosing the goal is not sufficient. In pursuing it also, we should be equally. Last night, in the Bar Association unveiling ceremony, unveiling of portrait of Singh, I had narrated a small story about truth. Swamiji was there. I was hesitating, but he himself asked me to just repeat it. What will be the useful of truth, of being truthful? How it be? Sometimes being truthful will be a bit inconvenient for us, but at the same time, though being truthful may delay success to you, it ultimately brings about a sustained and long-standing the stable success and full of values. Once the small story goes like this. A big gathering was there. One Swamiji was preaching, and he preached that it is always better to be truthful, and truth alone will triumph in the ultimate analysis. Everybody, the discourse was over. Everybody went in their own way. They understood. Some people thought of inculcating it. Some people take it lightly and all that. One of the persons who attended was a professional thief. He too attended. He was finding, because it was not night time, he will be busy only during nights. So because it was daytime, he came. And he heard everything, and he can't ask the Swamiji in the presence of all. After everybody left, he went to the Swamiji and said, "Sir, I am a thief by profession. If you want everybody to be truthful, and if I am truthful, what will be my fate? And if I have to be truthful, I will be behind bars and all that." Then he said, "All through you have been practicing. Sometimes you have been successful. Sometimes you have gone to jail. You came back. All this. Then why don't you try once?" All right, he has chosen to be faithful to the Swamiji, and on that night he was proceeding. Then he came across the king who was going in disguise in those days. The king was going in disguise to see what is happening in the country and in the city. Then he, both of them came across. Then the king in disguise, in a disguised way, he asked, "Who are you?" Then Swamiji's word came to his mind. He should speak truth. He said, "I am a thief." Then the king was a bit astonished. How dare this fellow say he is a thief and all that? Then all right, then where are you going? Where do you commit theft today? "Sir, I have not yet decided. Wherever it happens, I will do it." Then the king was also getting anxious. Then he said, "All right, if I show some place, what will you do?" Then once again he was remaining so truthful. "All right, you show me the place and I will commit theft 50-50. Whatever I get, you will share 50. Then the king didn't want to take chances. If he shows somebody else's house, both of them are caught, all of them will be behind bars. What he thought was, he took his own treasury. Then he has shown to the thief, "There is a box. It contains diamonds, very big diamonds. Go and commit theft." The thief went there. He opened it. There were 3 big diamonds. Then the promise was, the understanding was, they should share equally. If 3 are taken, there will be difficulty. Therefore, he picked up only 2 and told the king. He didn't know that he is king. "There are 3, but since we can't divide them, I brought only 2. This is your share, this is my share." They went away. Morning, because this man was a proclaimed offender or professional thief, because his list, wherever theft occurs, these persons will be presented there. So morning, the king announced there was a theft right in the treasury. Then all these proclaimed offenders, including this man, were presented in the court. That is his darbar. Then once again this man, Swamiji's words were coming to him, right? "Yes, last night theft occurred, diamonds were stolen, who is it?" Then he said, "Let me be truthful, yes, I have stolen 2, there were 3, I have taken 2, 1, I don't know who is the, he has shown me the place, I have taken, this is the one, if you want, you take it, otherwise leave it." Because he wanted to be truthful. Then what the minister, the chief minister of that, or the principal secretary, he was assisting the king. He has gone there, he found one diamond there. So anyway, theft has taken place. Let the blame go on the, he took it and he was telling the king, no, he is saying only 2 diamonds, but the 3rd diamond also may have been stolen by that fellow. We will trash that fellow, he will tell the truth. And the king knows all this. Then the king said, "He no doubt has stolen it, but he is truthful. Whereas you are my minister, you are the actual thief." Then he dismissed the thief. He dismissed his minister and offered that ministry to the thief. "Because, sir, you claim to be thief, but you are so truthful, I want you to be your minister." The climax is here. The thief says, "I practiced truth for one day and returned, I got an offer for ministership. I don't want it, I will try it later on. Let me try the truth once again." So this may be said in a lighter vein or whatever it is, but if you practice it, the result will be much more than this. Much more than, I am honestly telling you, it will be much more than this. Sometimes we may not get the immediate result of being truthful, but the respect which a person gets on account of his being truthful is much more than that. You will come across in the society, take for instance, whether in a city or village, somebody is known for his truthfulness and simplicity, but poor. Another person is dishonest. He changes the models of his car every year, very big bungalow, every sort of facility is there. His children and himself visit outside countries every year. And what will other people think about them? This man will be respected to the core, whereas he will be hated. Even if he has got something honestly, we'll feel that this man is a very dubious personality. He will go on cheating everything. Whatever he got is only an ill-gotten money. So truthfulness always helps a person in whatever is the walk of life. But that would be possible if only we try to lead a simple life. That's why always this, it is not in a lighter wind, they said, high thinking and simple living. How much do you want ultimately? If you define your necessities, which in turn, I am not asking you to undergo any fast or just be very poor, in a poor taste and all that. Lead a respectable life, but define your honest needs. Then you are the ultimately respected person. And particularly you, the girls for whom the whole nation is waiting, not only you, the biggest wealth which India can now claim is not the ill-gotten money stashed in Swiss banks or the glittering golden ornaments and all that. The biggest wealth for us is the youth, which is about 30% of our population. And if that youth is properly put in, it is put in proper order, the country, as that Scandinavian woman had said, it will continue to be heaven. And the boys, kindly don't mistake me, but our education is such that it is completely devoid of values. We are just unable to distinguish between what is education and what is other things. A true process of learning comprises of certain stages. First is information. Then that information must transform into knowledge. Then knowledge must become wisdom. It is only that wisdom that is true education, and that wisdom, for an ultimate analysis, it transforms into emancipation for some rare people. But we should become wise on account of our education. What is happening? There is a system before you, just a button. You get whole lot of information all over the world, whether it is relevant for you, irrelevant and all that. You feel that you are educated. That is not education. It is, you are having access to information. Having access to information is not, it is as good as you are going through a market where everything is there. You should decide what is necessary for you, what is not necessary. But unfortunately, you are being able to have access to information, people are thinking it as education. And where is it leading? You have access to everybody's information, irrelevant, all that. And that will occur to you at the cost of your concentration towards values. If dozens of people who are resorting to chain snatching are found to be engineering college students, very sorry to say that engineering college students are found to be the chain snatchers. What is the level of education? What did that man learn? He has only learnt something to clear the examination, but totally devoid of values. He doesn't know how to lead life and what all that he needs that money for some illegal purposes. That is not the type of education. And our girls and one woman folk, notwithstanding all these temptations, they are the disciplined lot, and you are the future of the country. If you just keep few tenets taught by Swami Vivekananda, that will be a real tribute not only to Swami Vivekananda but to the Mother India, but it will be an occasion to shape our lives. There is our selfishness also in that. On the one hand, we will be enriching our glory, and on the other hand, we will be shaping our life in a proper manner. That's why our shlokas just now have been chanted. One of it says, Udyavam sahasam dhairyam buddhi shakti parakrama shadete yatra vartante tatra daivam prasidati. God is there where persons with these tenets are there. When you are worshipping and all that is an extra thing. But if you possess these qualities, Udyavam sahasam dhairyam buddhi shakti parakrama, these do not need any special training nor any special course. They are within you. Just remove the small curtain that is there, and you will turn out to be a courageous and great citizen. And let us be proud of the legacy which Swami Vivekananda has left for us. And I profoundly thank all of you and the Swamiji's for giving me this opportunity. It would have been my pleasure to be with you throughout, but for the fact that I had to attend a similar function in Warangal, I would have been here. Thank you very much once again.